This is our first holiday special, and with my love of Christmas and politics and Star Wars, it's going to be a little different.
Hurry! We can't hold it!
Go about the business.
Move along.
From a galaxy far, far away.
I should somehow do a Jedi mind meld.
To the halls of power in Washington.
Mike Lee, I am your father.
I'm not the Emperor of the United States.
To the North Pole and back again.
Oh, that's kind of weird.
This is Craig Patrick's Politics and Christmas Family Holiday Special. Featuring appearances from celebrity guests.
Are you Ben Affleck?
Yes.
A celebration of Festivus.
A Festivus for the rest of us!
Are you stupid?
I am tired of this!
With performances by the Heralds of Harmony Choir. Plus, a visit from Santa.
So you're going through extra dimensions?
On occasion.
And mischief from the Grinch.
And I'm right behind him like, skee!
And it all starts now.
Ho, 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 ho! Merry Christmas, everyone!
Hello, I'm Craig Patrick. Thank you for joining us for our Money, Power, and Politics holiday special. We have Santa, we have the Grinch, and we even have a full choir. And to get us warmed up, the choir will pump up the Christmas spirit for precisely 30 seconds. That's the challenge, starting with Ding Dong, Ding Dong. Heralds of Harmony, take it away.
Ding dong, ding dong, merrily now we carol along. Ding dong, ding dong, Christmas bells are ringing. Caroling, 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 can't you hear the joyful sound? Up and down, caroling through the town. Hear the sound, hear the joyful sound.
Nice. While they bring us good cheer, we have a villain on our show also tonight who will try to take it away. And that brings us to our annual visit from the Grinch.
Here's your Christmas gift.
You're a mean one.
This year, our politicians got an early visit from the Grinch.
Once again, the Grinch is back.
And as we look back at 2015, the Grinch stole the show.
It does pain me.
The Grinch took John Boehner's job and Rick Scott's ability to pronounce the word manufacturing.
We have an ambitious agenda to keep Florida working and permanently eliminate the tax on manufacturing equipment.
He also swiped Scott's memory when it came to promising 700,000 jobs on top of normal growth.
It'll be the 700,000, you know, plus what would be normal.
It's on top of that.
On top of what normal growth would be.
I don't know who said that.
700,000 on top of.
No.
And he took Scott's pledge not to block an expansion of health care for the poor.
I'm not going to stand in the way. That's what I've said.
I'm not going to support it.
And the Grinch also snuck up on the man responsible for restoring honesty and integrity to the VA and stole his honesty and integrity.
Special Forces. What years? I was in Special Forces.
I incorrectly stated that I, too, had been in Special Forces. That was wrong, and I have no excuse.
You may know the Grinch also has a long history of swiping records that could make Hillary Clinton look bad, from the Rose Law Firm to the White House travel office. And this year, he struck again by taking her emails and wiping her server, which contained private emails with her husband that he said he never sent.
I think I'm probably the most transparent person in public life.
At the state capitol, the Grinch took the words climate change right off the table, making it look as if Governor Scott banned anyone on his staff from even saying the words.
What were those words you were using?
I used climate change.
Future versions of our mitigation plan will be required to have language discussing that issue.
What issue was that?
The issue that you mentioned earlier regarding.
The Grinch had also once scored last by snatching the last page of Marco Rubio's big speech.
I left my last page of the speech. Does anybody have my last page?
But this year, he robbed Jeb Bush by stealing his energy.
You know what's happening to Jeb's crowd, as you know, right down the street? They're sleeping. They're sleeping now.
And the Grinch topped it off by swiping the whole pack of energy drinks Jeb needed to keep his supporters awake through his lecture on the inner workings of corporate health savings accounts.
You may have an HSA in some companies don't.
Jeb, for all your sleeping needs.
It makes you wonder how one green fiend can pull it all off.
You're a mean one.
Mr. Grinch.
Is there only one Grinch, or are there many right now in the halls of Congress?
There is only one true Grinch, and that's this guy. Those other guys are imposters.
While the Grinch stole quite a bit from our politicians, he gave us a lot of material to work with. And that brings us to another holiday tradition that started as a joke.
A Festivus for the rest of us!
But a made-up holiday on Seinfeld came to life a couple of years ago in the Florida State Capitol.
Happy Festivus, everyone.
Basically, with Festivus, instead of a tree, you put up an aluminum pole like this. And instead of good cheer, you tell people how much they disappointed you with an airing of grievances.
Are you stupid?
And it wraps up with the feats of strength, in which the host orders someone to be tackled and pinned to the floor. So, let's get started.
Did you have a conversation,
Mr. Chairman?
I am tired of this.
This report says it was not successful.
The report's full of crap.
Last year, as you may recall, our Festivus airing of grievances kicked off with Obamacare architect Jonathan Gruber.
We are here today to beat up on Jonathan Gruber. For stupid.
Stupid.
Absolutely stupid.
Stupid man.
I behave badly.
This year, in our airing of grievances, we have to start with Jeb Bush.
Governor Bush.
Yeah.
After losing his energy to the Grinch, Bush really took the spirit of Festivus to heart.
This is like, chill out, man. I mean, come on. Let's just take a deep breath.
People need to work longer hours.
I'm not sure we need $500 million for women's health issues.
Don't yell at me behind my ear, though.
Sorry about that. Jeez.
Before he ran for president, Jeb Bush was known as the smart brother.
Every child can learn.
Children do learn.
A smart energy policy.
We need an energy bill that encourages consumption.
I visited over 400 Florida schools.
I hear there's rumors on the internets.
But as a candidate, Jeb could not get out of his own way.
Knowing what we know now, would you have authorized the invasion?
I would have. Taking out Saddam Hussein turned out to be a pretty good deal.
Governor, do you regret using the term anchor babies yesterday on the radio?
No, I didn't. Hey, Governor, I don't regret
it. You don't regret it?
No, do you have a better term?
And frankly, it's more related to Asian people coming into our country, having children.
As it turns out, his mother was trying to help him.
I would hope that someone else would run.
Well, Hillary Clinton is running, and we have to call her out for refusing to say she's sorry about her self-inflicted email troubles until she made a calculated decision to come across as more spontaneous and contrite.
As I look back at it now, even though it was allowed, I should have used two accounts, one for personal, one for work-related emails. That was a mistake. I'm sorry about that.
Meanwhile, President Obama aired his grievances for Festivus behind closed doors. According to David Axelrod, he said that Maureen Dowd really gets under Obama's skin when she tries to get inside of his head.
Gosh, doesn't it get you just frustrated?
Axelrod claims Obama is particularly displeased when the media tries to psychoanalyze him.
Sort of like the lump of coal you get for Christmas.
Which, of course, could relate to his need to be liked or to look cool under fire, which may go back to a complicated childhood, being different from the other kids and trying to compensate for it by bringing people together, then getting kicked around like a soccer ball when he tries it in Washington.
Has this been the worst year of your presidency?
And this probably was the worst year for the Florida legislature.
Dysfunctional.
Nice.
Dishonest.
Inept.
Illegally rigging political districts, admitting to it, failing to fix it, burning through millions of dollars.
Sonny Dye, all in favor signify by saying yay. Yay!
Illegally quitting early and going home while celebrating their failure with thunderous applause. What more can you say?
The height of chutzpah, I call it.
Celebrities!
They even declared freedom from the press, locked the public out of a healthcare meeting, leaving reporters to press their ears to the door to try to shine light on government in the Sunshine State.
Liberty!
And then there was Trump, telling us he's a lot like Ronald Reagan.
I thought a bit of the shining city upon a hill.
Our country is a total mess.
And teeming with people of all kinds, living in harmony and peace.
They're rapists.
For all the pilgrims from all the lost places.
I will build a great, great wall.
And if there had to be city walls, the walls had doors.
I will make that wall impenetrable.
And so we close out the airing of grievances and wrap up Festivus with the finale, or the feats of strength. For the annual tackling and pinning to the floor, as host of this year's Festivus ceremony, I call on Donald Trump.
Hey, look at this! Donald Trump! Donald Trump!
And so Festivus may be over so we can take down the poll, but we're still a long way from finished, and your kids may want to see this. We have a one-on-one with Santa, and he'll explain how he does it.
We fly faster than most of the molecules move.
And we'll show you how America's first Christmas played out on the shores of Tampa Bay.
As observant Catholics, they would have had a Christmas mass.
Then we'll go way back in time to that galaxy far, far away. When we cover politics, we point out a lot of things that politicians say that you can't always trust. But children all around the world believe in Santa Claus for good reason. And I caught up with him just before the Christmas rush to figure out how he makes the rounds.
Call sign, Big Red One. We can confirm that Santa is airborne at this time.
Every year, Santa Claus gets clearance and support from the highest levels of government.
I appreciate Santa coming.
Santa delivers everywhere.
But now we finally know how he does it.
47 factorial divided by 6 factorial.
Scientists have figured out the math. Santa Claus must fly more than 3,600 miles per second to visit all the nice children of Earth.
I'm fast.
To pull it off in one night, engineers say Santa may not take off from the North Pole. They say his most efficient route would start near Kazakhstan. From there, Santa would have to fly against the Earth's rotation and cross the date line. That way, scientists say he could, in fact, reach 2.5 billion homes between Christmas Eve and Christmas morning. Now, he would only have 34 microseconds per stop here, but that may be just enough to protect the presents and stay one step ahead of the Grinch.
Santa's all, I'm coming down the chimney, and I'm going to put stuff in your stocking. I'm going to put stuff under your tree, and I'm right behind him like, skee!
At that speed, you may think Santa's sleigh would hit so much air resistance, it would catch on fire.
You would think so.
How do you pull it off?
We have a magic gel we put on it.
And that allows the sleigh to travel through folds of time and space.
We fly faster than most of the molecules move.
So you're going through extra dimensions?
On occasion.
If that's the case, never mind a route. He can deliver gifts as we speak. How many gifts did you just deliver?
More than I could count.
Well, he just did it again. String theory, or M theory, suggests there are actually 11 different dimensions that weave in and out of our time and space. And Santa may be using at least 10 of them.
Can you take me to the North Pole?
Don't usually do that, Craig, but if you want to go.
Oh, that's kind of weird.
And so goes the science of Santa Claus.
Ho, 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 ho! Merry Christmas, everyone! Ho, 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 ho!
Well, you know, Florida celebrates Christmas with light shows and boat parades and theme parks and resorts that draw millions of people all around the world. But you may not know that Florida also hosted America's first Christmas right here on the shores of Tampa Bay. America's first Christmas season started in Bradenton nearly 500 years ago. DeSoto National Park marks the spot for Hernando de Soto and his Spanish expedition. But you may not know these early explorers also celebrated America's first Christmas. Or rather, they celebrated in a land that would become the United States nearly 250 years later.
Soto brought priests along, and that is observant Catholics, they would have had a Christmas mass.
DeSoto and more than 600 others left Tampa Bay in 1539 and tracked north. And archaeologists found the spot where they settled for Christmas. Today, it's a small park near downtown Tallahassee.
Although it probably did not resemble the Christmas trees and Santa Claus that we associate with Christmas, it would have been more of a solemn occasion with a mass.
The archaeologists found a lot of artifacts from the site.
And that type of pipe is actually made in Tampa Bay.
And they found pig bones, which may suggest their Christmas Day feast included pork.
To avoid starvation, they brought a herd of pigs with them, which probably introduced wild pigs to the southeast.
Archaeologist Dr. Dan Seinfeld said they also raided the Native Americans' food supply. And they did not write about their Christmas celebration because it was not exactly a time of peace.
We have evidence historically of conflict with the Apalachee, fighting because the Apalachee fiercely resisted the Spanish occupation.
This was a dangerous military expedition that sought conquest over peace. But our legislature and historians say it was also a critical turning point for all of us, well worth remembering long beyond Christmas. Christmas in Florida has changed a lot over the years. And this year, for a lot of kids and adults who grew up in the 1980s, this Christmas brings the gift of Star Wars as The Force Awakens.
What's going to become of this Galactic Republic?
Hopefully good things in the future.
And in a way, the story of Star Wars mirrors America's story. Both launched as revolutionary experiments, took off with a combination of imagination and innovation the world had never seen, then got bogged down in politics. And at least until J.J. Abrams took over, it just got silly.
The Empire will strike back.
Well, Ted Cruz gets Star Wars, like most children of the 80s, which incidentally puts him a step above Marco Rubio, who must have spent the 80s on another planet.
I think I had the Death Star, but it kept breaking, just like it did in part two. And in Empire Strike Back, when it blew up because the guy got that rocket to go into that hole, remember that?
No, the Death Star did not blow up in Empire Strikes Back.
That was my favorite.
But while politicians on both sides try to relate to Star Wars, they see it in two very different ways. For example, to hear Democrats tell it, the last Republican administration was a team of Sith Lords with an apprentice and his master behind the scenes, leading us into a trumped-up war. Democrats say they elected Obama as the new hope, a guardian of peace and justice, seeking change in troubled times. But to hear Republicans tell it, President Obama was that charming senator who transformed into the emperor before their very eyes.
I believe in the Constitution and I will obey the Constitution of the United States. Believe me, the idea of doing things on my own is very tempting.
I should somehow do a Jedi mind meld.
Wherever and whenever I can take steps without legislation, that's what I'm going
to
do.
I really want Congress to do its job, the constitutional power that they have, to halt an imperial presidency.
But while Obama did overstep his authority with recess appointments to the Senate, and arguably more than that, despite what Republicans say, he's not the emperor.
I'm not the emperor of the United States.
And his own struggles just to govern prove that.
And since I'm in charge, obviously we screwed it up.
Meanwhile, the last Republican administration did make mistakes, but was not the Sith. And the Republican candidates are not Dark Lords either, regardless of what Ted Cruz may have said in the Senate.
Mike Lee, I am your father.
All right, when we come back, we'll bring back Santa Claus and try to figure out if he's a Republican or a Democrat.
Are you more likely to hang out with Sean Penn or John Voight?
And we'll show you how Santa is influencing some key players in national and state politics. Democrats like to play Santa Claus by promising gifts and benefits for millions.
I appreciate Santa coming.
But Republicans also like to play Santa Claus by promising tax cuts without sacrifice.
It is truly a special time of year.
In a rare pre-Christmas interview, Santa agreed to meet with us in an undisclosed location.
When you're doing surveillance on the boys and girls, do you run this through a FISA court?
And he agreed to talk politics.
Do the elves take jobs away from American workers?
No.
We found some clues that he may line up with the Republicans.
Do you ever wear blue?
No.
But then again, maybe not.
You make a lot of appearances in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
You spread good cheer.
I do.
Another way to say that would be you spread the wealth.
Well, that's the whole original concept of Santa.
He's hard to pin down.
Are you more likely to hang out with Sean Penn or John Voight?
Actually, I don't hang out with very many named stars.
Though he runs a global charity and has access to large deposits of coal, Santa does not play politics.
Really, Santa Claus is not interested in politics.
And politicians should not play him. After all, politicians don't always give the best gifts.
It really was a horrible gift. Letter opener. Home socks.
Chicken.
All right. Inside, we figured out the perfect way to wrap up our Money, Power, and Politics family holiday special. We'll have a special send-off from the Heralds of Harmony Choir and from all of us when we come back.
Thank you to the Heralds of Harmony Choir. I'd also like to thank Charles and Robin Carter, who helped us put this special together, and our entire team and family, especially for this little finale we're doing here at the end. In the spirit of a show called The Homecoming, the Christmas classic that launched a show called The Waltons, it's time to say goodnight. Everybody quiet down now and get some sleep.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, Linda.
Good night, Vanessa.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night, Marissa.
Good night, Kevin.
Good night, Marissa.
Good night, Kevin and Marissa.
Good night, everybody. Whatever happened to Jim Bob?
Yeah, where is Jim Bob?
Good night, everybody.
Good night, Charlie.
Good night, Mark.
And good night, Dad.
Good night and farewell.
Good morning, everybody. It's time for Good Day.
Russell, we're all trying to sleep.
Oh, sorry. Good night, John Boy.